Today we will discuss the heat and molecular theory. Also, we will discuss the thermodynamics, the first law and the second law of the thermodynamics specifically. Also, yeah, remember you had to complete the lab 13, which is the specific heat. Please watch the video, which was posted in Canvas. Complete the lab sheet and submit it online. Also, complete the homework number 5. What happened when the phase change occurred in the material? And in this example, we had a solid material, can be, for example, a piece of ice. What happened if we add heat to the material? Yes, what happened if we increase the temperature of the material? If we increase the temperature of the material, what is going to happen is the molecules start moving faster. Yes, in this case, in the solid case, we had something like that, the structure of the molecules. If we add heat to this material, can be ice, then what happens is the molecules start moving faster. They not only vibrate, they can rotate and they can translate a small distance. What happens if we add even more heat to the water, to that substance? And if we add more heat, what happens is the molecules have more energy, they can move even faster, and they can not only vibrate, they can rotate, but they can move larger distance compared with the size of the molecules. Then, in order to the phase change occur, we need to add some heat. How we can add heat? We can add heat through the temperature difference, or we can add heat if this substance absorbs energy from any other form, yes, like radiant energy, for example. Then in this case, when we add heat to the materials, then they can convert into solid to liquid. And in this case, we will say the melting occur or can be more changed from liquid to gas. And in this case, we say the vaporization occur. Also, can be in the reverse way. We had gas, and then the material release energy. The material release energy, and then this, if release energy, can transform gas into liquid, and this process called condensation, or liquid to solid, and this process called freezing point. Also, remember the temperature increase according to the specific heat of the substance. As remember, the specific heat of the substance is the constant value that correlates the heat and the change in temperature. As this is the specific heat. Then in this slide, we had the diagram for phase change that represent the plot of temperature versus heat. The heat that is absorbed by the material, or can be also the heat that is released by the material. Then what happened? What happened when we add heat of the material? And in this case, we had a solid material. Yes, we add heat to the material, means if we add heat, the temperature of the material is going to increase. And in some point, what happened with this solid is going to convert into liquid. Yes, and this part we had liquid, the material is in liquid state. Then what happened if we add even more heat? this solid is going to convert into gas. And if we add more heat, temperature is changes, yes, it's increasing. As we can see here, we add heat, temperature increases. We add heat, also temperature increases. But there are some part of the graph, we can see the B and D part of the graph, is the temperature is not increasing, but we are increasing the energy, the heat, yes? Then what happened is the temperature is not increasing. Why the temperature is not increasing? And in this part of the graph is where the phase change occurred. And in this case is all the energy are used to change the phase from solid to liquid. This is why the energy is not increasing the temperature of the material, it's just used, this energy is used to change the phase. And this is why here the temperature is not increasing, it's where the phase change occurs. Here also, even if we increase the energy, the temperature is not increasing. Again, is the energy is used to change the phase. And this is why, even if we increase the energy, the temperature is not changing. It's constant temperature. And in this is where the phase change occurs. Then if the phase occurs from solid to liquid, then it's called melting. And if it's the phase occurs from liquid to gas, is vaporization. And in these cases, the energy is absorbed. But if the phase occurs from gas to liquid, is called condensation, or from liquid to solid is freezing. And in these cases, in this direction, the energy is released. Then what happened in this? Then we know how to calculate the Q value when there is a change in temperature. But how we can calculate the Q value, the heat, when the temperature is constant? Then first we will define what kind of heat we had in this case. Then this heat is called the latent heat and is the hidden energy of a phase. Means is the energy that goes or comes out of the potential energy of the material. Is the energy that changed the internal energy of the material. Is the energy that changed the energy of the molecules, that changed the vibration, then the motion of the molecules. Then in this case, the energy, if we add more energy, now is in solid, when the material is in solid state, they just can vibrate, but if you add more, they can rotate, they can vibrate, and they can move a small distance, but if you add more energy, they can move larger distance. Yes. And it's the latent heat is the energy needed to the phase change occur. Yes. This is the latent heat. We are interested in how to calculate the total amount of heat that is absorbed or is released during phase transition. Then we want to calculate how much heat need to convert this into solid to liquid, for example, or from liquid to gas, or from solid to gas. Then in order to do that, we need to calculate the specific heat in the different states. Then we need to calculate the heat in each part of the diagram, A, B, C, D, E. Yes. And let's start with the A part, yes, when there is the solid. Then in this case, we will calculate the heat will be the mass of the substance, the specific heat, and we have to be careful here, is the specific heat in solid state. Yes? If it's, for example, water, will be the specific heat of the ice, multiplied by delta T. What is the delta T? Is the change in temperature from this point to this point. Let's discuss the part C first and part E also, which we had change in temperature, as we had change in temperature when we increase the energy. Then in this case, because there is change in temperature, we can apply this equation, and this is will be one moment. Equals to the mass of the substance, the specific heat of the liquid times the change in temperature. Again, the change in temperature from this point to this point. And finally, in the last part of the graph, we had the specific heat in the E part will be the mass C times delta T. But here the specific heat will be specific heat of the gas. Again, the delta T is the change in temperature from this point to this point. Then it's important to clarify this delta T values are not the same, they are different. And now how we can calculate the heat needed to phase change, as in this, the heat needed to phase change. When we need to use another equation, the reason is in this part there is no change in temperature, but we know there is some energy that is needed to change the phase. And what we can do is we will use another equation, is the latent heat, and how we will calculate that will be, in this case, because it's freezing or melting, let's use B. B will be the mass times the latent heat of freezing. And in this part, we had in the deep part is the latent heat of vaporization, the deep part. Let me correct that. D equal to the mass of the substance multiplied by the latent heat of vaporization. And this is the way how we can calculate the total heat. How we will calculate the total heat? Yes, we will do is the total heat equals to, we add all the heat, the different heat in different states. Again, depend on the problem. Sometimes just they are asking for the first two. Yes. They can ask for the first three. Then you have to read the problem. Sometimes you need to calculate just the A and B heat or A, B, C, depend again on what you have to find in the specific problem. And so this is just to summarize. Then if we had ice, yes, in solid state, then the if we increase the heat and we increase the temperature, this ice is going to melt at 0 degrees Celsius. Yeah. And this is the heat needed to bring the ice from minus 20 to 0 degrees. This is the heat needed. But to change the phase is this heat. And how we will calculate this? Using this equation, the mass time multiplied by the latent heat of fusion. Then to bring the water from 0 to 100 degrees Celsius, we need this amount of heat. And remember the specific heat in this case with the specific heat of the water. Then to calculate how much heat we need to change the phase, we will use in this case the latent heat of vaporization, which is the mass by the latent heat of vaporization. This latent heat of fusion and vaporization are the constant value for a specific substance. And that values are constant values for a specific substance. In this course, yes, we will for solve the problems, we will use the water systems. In all the cases, we will calculate the heat for phase change of the water. This is the only system we will use in our problems. Then, finally, to increase the temperature when it's already vapor, to increase the temperature of the vapor, we can use this equation. But here, the specific heat must be the specific heat of the vapor. Then the latent heat of fusion is the heat involved in a solid liquid phase change in melting or freezing chain phase. And the vaporization is how much heat we need to change from water to vapor or steam. If we are in the other way, yes, if we are from vapor to liquid, the value is the same. Yes, in one case, the heat will be absorbed. In another case, the heat will be released, but the amount of heat is the same. This is why the latent heat of fusion or the vaporization, they are the same. Doesn't matter what is the direction in which the phase, in the chain phase occur. This table is in your equation sheet, and because in all the problems, the substance we will use is water, and we need to know the specific heat of the water is 1 Cal gram per degree Celsius. Ice is 0.5 and steam or vapor is 0.48. The latent heat of fusion for water, you see this is for water, yes, these values are for water. The latent heat of vaporization is, the latent heat of fusion is 80 calories per gram. At the latent heat for vaporization for water is 540. And this we discussed before is the equivalent between calories and joules. Then 1 kilocalorie equals 4,184 joules. Is the conversion factor between calories and joules. Kilocalories and joules. Then all these constants, all these values correspond to water. And this is the only values we will use to solve our problems. Okay? And they are in your equation sheet. In this example, we want to calculate how much energy, means how much heat, does a refrigerator remove from 100 grams of water at 20 degrees Celsius to make ice at minus 10 degrees Celsius. Then we want to know how much energy and how much heat is released when the water changes from liquid to ice. If the initial temperature of the water is 20 degrees Celsius and the final temperature of the ice is minus 10 degrees Celsius. Then the first thing we want to write is what information we had. It's mass. We had the initial temperature, which is 20, and the final temperature, which is minus 10. But we had to be careful because we cannot use the equation the heat equal mass specific heat times delta T. We cannot use directly this equation, and the reason is there is a phase change in water. That phase occurs at 0 degrees Celsius. Then what I suggest you always is to make a diagram that you represent the information you had in the problem. Then less y. Here this is the temperature at, and here we have the heat, the energy in this axis. Then another important temperature, because This is water. In all the cases we had water as a substance, then what I suggest you is remember these three temperatures. One, these two temperatures. One is 100 degrees Celsius, is the boiling temperature of the water. Is it 100? The other temperature I suggest you to remember is 0 degrees Celsius. At this temperature, the water is changed from liquid to solid. Yes, this is the freezing point of the water. And the other temperature we want to right here is the temperature we had in the problem. It's not a scale, okay, but this is, we know 20 is between 0 and 100 in some point, and here we have minus 10. Then now we want to graph what is happening with the water when the temperature is decreasing and the is release is and the water is releasing energy. And the water is at this temperature, 20 degrees Celsius, and what happened is the temperature is decreasing, the water is releasing heat, then but at 0 degrees Celsius we had to stop and remember at this temperature there is a change phase in water. Then in this temperature all the energy is used to change the phase. Yes, it's here. Then once the water is converted into solid, the temperature starts decreasing at 2. Then we need to calculate the heat for each segment of the graph. Yes? Then we calculate for the first segment. This is just call this one is 1 equals, because there is a change in temperature. Then we can calculate, this is the mass of the water, which we know, the specific heat of the water, because it's liquid, yes, it's 20 degrees Celsius, it's room temperature. Then water multiplied by delta T. What delta T? Delta T from 20 to 0 is 20 degrees Celsius. In this course, also in your book, they are taken for all the cases. Delta T greater than 0 means delta T is always positive, or in other words, they always take the absolute value of the delta T, because absolute value is always greater than 0. And just we will use words to indicate if the heat is released or is absorbed. If it's released, usually they will say the heat is negative, and if it's absorbed, because it's gain heat, the material is gain heat, is positive. But don't worry for the signs, just we will say if the heat is released or is absorbed. In this case, it's released, yes, because it's liquid into solid. Yes. Then we are not going to worry for the signs, just we will take always the delta T as positive value, okay? And in the second segment, what we had here is a phase change. Then we had, let's do this one, because it's change, we will use this equation. There is no delta T. Delta T equals 0. Then we cannot use this. We cannot use this equation. Then this is latent heat of fusion for water. And in the last segment, in this segment, we will use the mass, a specific heat of ice, because below of this one, we had ice times delta T. What delta T? Delta T will be 0, between 0 and 10 is 10 degrees Celsius. Remember, we don't worry about the sign. Okay, we will say using our words if the heat was released or would absorb. And let's see, we need some constant. We need the specific heat for water, which is one calories per gram 4 degrees Celsius, the specific heat for ice, which is 0.5, and the latent heat of fusion for the water, which is 80 calories per gram. And this, again, these constant values, these are in your equation sheet, all these values. Okay, then you can check them. And let's, right here, we need, it's 1 point calories. This is for ice, which is 0.5. And finally, latent heat of fusion will be 80.0 gram. So it's calories per gram. Calories per gram. Now we had all the values we need to calculate the heat in each segment. Let's start with the first one. Is the mass will be. And let's start with this, okay? Let me mark this one. Then mass. This mass is 100 grams times the specific heat for water is 1. Times delta T, 20, 0, yes? The difference between the delta T between 20 and 0 will be 20 degrees Celsius. And let's check the units. This cancel out, this cancel out, and finally we had in calories. That is the unit we expected for heat. And this is 1000 calories. Let's calculate the heat in the second segment. This is mass, which is 100 grams. Times the specific heat, sorry, the latent heat fusion for water, which is 80, times 80 calories per gram. This cancel out, and finally we had 8,000 calories. Let's calculate for the third segment. The third segment we had the mass is again the same mass. The same amount of water. Ice is 0.5 calories gram. Delta T, 0 minus 10. The delta T is 10 degrees Celsius. Remember, delta T will be always positive. Then we don't worry for that. Then if we multiply these numbers together, we will have 500 calories. To calculate the amount of heat was released by the water, we just add together the total heat. Yes, this is T. Will be just we add the amount of heat that was released in each segment of our graph. Then it's 2000 calories plus calories plus 500 calories. Plus 500 calories. Then the total heat equals to 10,500 calories. And it's okay if you write this in scientific notation, if you want to write into the kilocalories, and if you want to write this one in scientific notation, is 10 point, yes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 10 point, let me write this one, is 1.05. Let me write this one in scientific notation. It's 1.05 10 to the power 1, 2, 3, 4 calories. This is can be one answer. Also, the other answer can be also you write in the third power, then to the power 1, 2, 3 with 10.5, 10 to the power 3 calories. But we know 10 to the power 3 is kilocalories, is kilo. Then you can write this one like 10.5 kilo, 10 to the power 3 is kilocalories. And any of these answers are the same thing, okay? And all are right. 10,500 calories, 1.05 10 to the power 4 calories, 10.5 10 to the power 3 calories, or 10.5 kilocalories. There are different ways you can write the same answer, and all of them are the same, are valid, okay? This is how much heat was released by the water when the temperature changed from 20 degrees Celsius to minus 10 degrees Celsius. Let's move to the next. And now we want to discuss about the thermodynamics. Thermo means heat, and dynamics means motion. Then this is the part of the physics that study the heat and its relation with the mechanical energy. Then if we want to convert mechanical energy into heat, we can do this one through friction. Yes, we can rub our hands. Yes, and if we rub our hands, we can see our hands become warm. Yes, that we can see they become warm, and this is because of friction. Yes. Then in this case, what we are doing is we are converting mechanical energy into heat. Yes. We are moving our hands, and that hands warm our hands. We are moving our hands, and this motion warm our hands. Yes. It's converting the mechanical energy into the heat. Then, but what happened is we want to convert heat into the mechanical energy. We need some device. We need a special device. Then this device is called the heat engine. Then here there is the simple explanation what is the heat engine. Remember, heat engine convert heat into the mechanical energy. And in this case, we had air in this beaker, and we had a piston here. Yes. We had gas, it's compressed here. And we had a piston here, and we had a weight on top of the piston. That what happened if we hit the air we had inside, the gas we had inside. If we hit the gas, the molecules start moving faster, and the gas will be expand. Then if the gas expand, what is going to happen? This is moving up the weight. Yes, the piston is going to move up. And also the weight. Then in this case, what happened is the heat, yes, which is the energy we add to the gas, is converted into the potential energy because it changes the height of the weight. Then we can see here, yes, sorry, it's not, here is the the weight was moving up. Yes, then it's moving this h distance. Then it changes the potential energy. And in this case, the heat was transformed in potential energy. Increase the potential energy of the weight. Then heat is changes into the mechanical energy. There is some laws of the thermodynamics. They laws describe what happened with the energy when this is transformed into work or in another form of energy. Then let's explain the general idea about the first law of thermodynamics. Then any system in some particular state had some internal energy. Remember, the internal energy is the energy associated with the molecules or the system. Yes. Then In this state, the molecules had some internal energy. If the state change means, for example, the volume change, the temperature change, the pressures change, then the system has another internal energy. Then each state is identified by some internal energy, the energy of the molecules. Yes? Each state is identified by the internal energy of the in that particular state. Then, but how we can change that internal energy? How we can change the internal energy? How we can change the motion of the energy of the molecules? How we can change that? Then there is one way we can change is we can add heat to the system. That's what we did in the previous example. We can add heat to the system. Also, the internal energy can change if that system that can do some work. Yes. Then because it's doing some work, will we lose some energy? Remember, heat, energy, and work, all they had the same units. Yes. They all are related to energy. Then how we can change the internal energy of the system is if we add heat to the system, or if the system is doing some work, can lose that energy. And in your book, this is the equation is in your book, which is the same equation. Just please don't confuse this. J is here. This is not a variable. This is just the conversion factor between the joules and calories. Okay. Then this is not any variable. It's just the conversion factor. And let's discuss a little more what is the about the heat engine. But now we can see if we pay attention to this equation, all our energies, yes, are in joules, joules, and joules, all are related to energies. Then the first law of the thermodynamics is just the application of the law of conservation of energy. As we cannot create or destroy energy, just the energy is transformed into another kind of energy. Yes, and this is application of the conservation of energy. Then what happened with heat engine is because heat engine is a cycle engine, it means is doing some work, yes, has some energy doing some work, then again the same energy doing some work, then the initial and the final states are the same. Then this is why the change in internal energy are zero. Because that is doing work by cycles. Yes, it's always the initial and the final states are the same. Then the delta U means the change in internal energy equals to zero. What happens if the change in internal energy equals zero? If this equation, the delta U, the change internal energy is zero, then what happens is this equal to this one. Is the heat added to the system is equal to the work done by the system. But what happens is this will be in the ideal case. Yes, this is in the ideal case. But this doesn't happen in the real machines. Yes, in the real heat engines. And what happened is to that machines, we can add some heat. They had some available energy to do some work. Then that part of this energy is doing the work, is converted into work. But what happened in the real machines, we lose some energy. Yes. We lose some energy, for example, in friction, in noise, in heat. Any machine always lose some energy. Not all the energy is available is converted into work. We lose some part of this energy. And this is why the net heat, the total heat, equals the heat that is doing really the work, is the heat we had available in the the high, this in your book they call the high temperature region, minus the heat we lose, or is the heat in the low temperature region. This is why the Q value, yes, this Q value, then we had here equal to heat, but the work equal to the heat, but the heat which is able to do work is the total heat available minus the heat we lose. Yes, lose. And this is why this is how we can calculate the work done by the heat engine. This is the equation we can use to calculate the work done by the heat engine. Again, in your book, the equation looks like this one, that J is just a conversion factor, it's not a variable. Okay? This is one specific example for heat engine is the steam engine. In the steam engine, in this case, we had water, and we heat the water. The water is converted into the steam. That steam span moved the piston, and this piston moved back and forth the wheel we had here, yes, through this cylinder. Then in this case, heat, yes, the heat is converted into work, is able to move the wheel, yes. Then in this case, the source of heat will be the heat we add here, yes, the heat with input. But not all this work, not all this energy, not all this heat is used to do this work. Part of this heat we lose in the process, and it's called is going to the sink. Yes, and the changes between Q1 and Q2 is the available heat to do this work. Yes, in this case, just they change this small numbers here, yes, but this will be the low heat and high heat. Yes, then we can calculate the work if we just subtract these two values of heat. Then the steam engine is a heat engine that performs mechanical work using steam, using heat, then convert heat into mechanical work. And two more examples for types of heat engines are the engine car and the steam car. This is two examples, real examples where the heat engine is used. And in this example, we had a heat engine that operates at 65 kilocalories. This is the heat we supply, or they can supply to the heat engine, and they lose 4 kilocalories of heat. As this exhausts, this is they lose that heat. And we want to know how much work the engine can do. Then I suggest you first to do some diagram. This diagram help you to understand what happened in the problem. And you had an engine which they supply 65 is the energy is available to do some work. Yes, it's 65 kilocalories. Then what happened with this is part of this energy is using to do some work. Yes, but not all the energy is using to do some work. Part of this energy is loose. Yes, this is, remember, this is the high temperature region, this is the low temperature region, is the energy we lose during that process. Then we have this energy available. Yes, we have this energy is available. Part of this energy is using to do some work, but also part of the energy is lost during the process. It's losing during the process. Then let's now calculate the work. Yes, this is, we don't know. Then work equals to, sorry, work. This is the work equals to, work equal to minus, and work equal to 65 kilocalories minus 40.0 kilocalories, and the work equal to 25.0 kilocalories. In some cases, we want to convert these kilocalories into joules, and in that case, just what we have to do is we need to use the conversion factor. Yes, what conversion factor is 1 kilocalorie equals to 4,184 joules. And let's use this conversion factor. Then we have 25.0 kilocalories. And to convert into joules, just we multiply by the wrong by the right conversion factor. Then kilocalories cancel out. We know it's right because kilocalories cancel out is the unit we don't want. And finally, we had in joules. Yes, joules is 10,000. Let me write the multiplication is 1,400 joules. Because we want 3 significant digits, then the work, let's write this one with 3 significant digits. It will be 105,000 joules. Then we had finally, we can write this one into the, you can write this one, let's write in the way is in your book, 1, 2, 3, 4 is 10.5 1, 2, 3, 4. No, they use 3 in the third power, 1, 2, 3 and 10 to the power 3 joules. And the reason they wrote in this way is because they want, yes, 10 to the power 3 is kilo, is 1,000 is kilo, then it's kilo joules. Any of these answers are right. Okay, these are, then you can write, if you write in this way is right, this way is right, and this way is right. Okay, any of these ways you write the answer is correct. Let's now discuss the second law of the thermodynamics. And this law say is the heat flows always from high temperature to low temperature side. Always from high temperature to low temperature side. Okay. Then, no, in the other way. If we want to move the energy from low temperature to high temperature, what we need? We need a device. Yes, we need a device. Then the heat flows naturally from high temperature region to low temperature region. Yes, from here we don't need to do anything. Yes, this is we did in the last experiment in class. Yes, we say we don't need to do anything. Yes, we need to connect the the hot water and cold water using the aluminum bar, yes, and the heat flow naturally. But if we want in the other direction, we need a special device. We need a special machine. This special device is called the heat pump. Yes. Then the heat pump is a machine is using to move heat from low temperature region to high temperature region. Yes. The heat pump is using to move heat from low temperature region to high temperature region. In order to do that, we need to do some work. We need to give some energy. Yes, we need to add some energy. We need to do some work to do that. And this is why the total heat we can get in the high temperature region will be equal to the energy we had in the low temperature region plus the work we had to do to move this heat from here to here. Okay. Then again, the heat we will have in the high temperature region equals to the energy we had in the low temperature region plus the work we had to do to move the heat from here to here. Okay. Another important point from in the second law of the thermodynamics is the efficiency of the engine, particularly of the heat engine. Then what happened is what we can conclude in after we discuss all this slides is if we had some energy or some heat available to do some work, all this heat is not converted into the work. Yes, we lose some part of this heat. Then to calculate how efficient is that machine, what we can do is calculate the ratio of the work is able that machine to do divide by how much is the total energy we supply to that machine. Yes. Then the efficiency, which is E, is the ratio between the work done by the machine divided by how much energy, how much heat we supply to that machine. Then the efficiency is the work done per unit input energy. Yes. Another thing is the efficiency cannot be equal to one, again, because all the heat we supply is not all the heat is doing the work. We lose some heat, as we lose some heat. Then the only case if this will be equal to one is all the heat we supply is converted into work, but it doesn't happen in the real life, in the real machines. Why? Because always some energy is going to degrade. And remember, you see these two equations are the same, just we wrote in different way to understand each machine. Is the work if we had some available energy, yes, high temperature region, then this energy can flow without do anything. Yes, this can flow to the low temperature region, but this part of this energy we can use to do some work. Yes. Then what is the available energy to do the work is the difference between the energy we supply minus the energy we lose. But if we want to move heat from low temperature region to high temperature region, what happened is we need to do some work because the heat is not going to flow naturally. Yes, we need to do some work to move heat from the low temperature region to high temperature region. And just remember the first law, I want to remember that is just the is the application of the conservation of the energy, in which the input energy must be equal to the output energy. And let's do this work, let's do this example to apply this equation. Then each cycle of heat engine is supplied with 350 kilocalories. This is the heat we supply. Yes, this is the high temperature region heat is 350. 350 kilocalories. And 350 kilocalories and rejects. Then this is the low temperature region is 220 kilocalories. And what is the efficiency? Unless this is the energy we had here, yes, then this is QH. Part of this energy is doing work, but we lose part of this energy, is degrading, yes. Again, part of this energy is using to do some work, but we lose part of this energy, and this is Q, low temperature reading. Then, now we know the efficiency is the work, the total available energy in the high temperature region. Then we know the high temperature, the heat in the high temperature region, but we don't know the work. But we know we can calculate the work. The heat in the high temperature region minus the heat in the low temperature region. And it's 350 kilocalories minus 220 kilocalories. Then the work will be 130 kilocalories. Then we calculate the work, but we need to calculate the efficiency. Then we can calculate now this one is work is 130 kilocalories divided by the high temperature region, the heat in the high temperature region is 350 kilocalories. Then we can see the energy cancel out. The efficiency doesn't have any unit. Yes, it's units less quantity. If we divide this one, we will have 0.37. And usually we write the efficiency in percentage, then the efficiency of this material is this machine is 37%. And in real, for real machines, the efficiency is usually no more than 60-70%. For example, for modern gasoline engines. Means cars, for example, had a maximum thermal efficiency of 25% and 50% only, because part of the energy is lost in heat, in friction, in sound. Then it's just for all heat is available. We use or the that machine used to do work just the 25% or the 50%. Yes, usually this is the percentage is used to do the work. The other energy is losing in the process. And finally, I want to just quickly discuss what you are going to do for lab 13, which is the specific heat. Then in this lab, what we want to calculate, or we want to determine is the specific heat of cadmium. Of this piece of metal, we want to calculate the specific heat, this value. Yes, we want to calculate the specific heat for that piece of metal. In this case, we report cadmium. And we want to compare this value with the theoretical value you will search in the internet. This is what we want to do. To do that, we will put this piece of metal into boiling water. You will watch this one in the video and you will take the data from the video, but I want to quickly say what you had to do to complete the lab sheet. Then this piece of metal you will put inside of the water. The water will be about 100 degrees Celsius. 100 degrees Celsius is the boiling temperature for the water, and this will be your initial temperature. Yes, this will be this value. Then you had to watch the video and you had to get all this data from that video. Okay, then the boiling temperature of the water, which be about 100 degrees Celsius, will be in this part. Then what we will do once we know the piece of metal is at 100 degrees Celsius also, then we transfer this piece of metal quickly into the cut coffee, in the coffee cup. We will transfer this into the coffee cup and we will put inside. But before to do that, just you will see you had to take the temperature, the initial temperature of the water, which will be about at room temperature, and this value will be in this part as initial temperature of the water and the initial temperature of the metal, and this will be the initial temperature of the water. Once you transfer the piece of metal, then yes, you will cover this. Now she will cover that, the person is doing the experiment, and then we had to wait to see the highest temperature possible, and this will be the final temperature, because we had water and piece of metal together, then this will be the final temperature for both. You see, this is why we don't have just final. Yeah, and this, when you put the metal inside the water and you measure the temperature, this is the final temperature for both. And what you had to do is you had to calculate the change in temperature for the water and the change of temperature for the metal. And then we know the specific heat for water, which is 1.00 calories gram per degree Celsius. And the idea is to calculate this value. To calculate this value, the specific heat of the metal, we need to know the heat lost by the metal when we put inside of the water, as how much heat was lost to the metal. Then to do that, what will we assume is all the heat lost by the piece of metal was gained by the water. Maybe this is not exactly true. We lose some part of the heat when we transfer, for example, but we will assume that, okay? The heat lost by the metal is equal to the heat gained by the water. Then if we know the heat gained by the water, we can cut. We will know also the heat lost by the metal, because they are equal. Then to calculate the heat gained by the water, we need to know the mass of the water. Then this information you will know from the video. We know the specific heat of the water is 1, and you can calculate the change in the temperature of the water. Then all this data you will get from the video. Once you calculate this one, you know this one, these two are equal, because you know this one, you will know this one. And you know the change in temperature, because you know these two values. From the video, you will get the mass of the metal, and you can calculate the specific heat of the metal. You know this one, you know this one, you know this one. That's solved for the specific heat of the metal. Then I hope this helps to know. Then remember, first watch the video, complete the lab sheet, and submit the lab sheet online. Okay. And then I think this is all I had for today. And we will please stay safe, and let's see in the next presentation. Okay, bye bye.